Hello and welcome to the APTA Grand Prix Series. We are live at the Short Hills Club in Summit, New Jersey on the APTA Network, presented by eNet Live in association with Kirk Media Productions. I'm Brad Easterbrook alongside Mark Fischel, and it's time for the men's semifinals between John Hughes and Mark Powers against Juan Araya and Jeff Morneau. The players are out on the court warming up. Why don't you tell us about our matches today?
Well, John Hughes and Mark Powers are a new team on the block. They've had a breakthrough year last year and maintained their ranking this year. Neither one is a teaching professional, but they're fun to watch, athletic, young. Mark Powers especially brings a really dynamic game, and he's going to be fun to watch today. These teams have played twice this year. Juan and Jeff won in straight sets at the Sound Shore Invitational in November. And then they played again at the Western New England's in December, and Hughes and Powers had them in all sorts of trouble. I think they were up 6-2, 4-1, 40-love before losing in three. Jeff Morneau was saying to me last night that they've won a lot of close matches this year, including back-to-back tournaments in Cincinnati down match point to Mick Odoi and Dan Regan, and then the finals 2 weeks ago in Boston to Durant Parsons, also down match point. And this match against Powers and Hughes is the match he thought they shouldn't won more than any of the others.
Yeah, that's interesting. So this is the third matchup between the teams. And in each case, you see there's a ton of talent out on the court there. It seems like Araya now and Morneau have adopted a style they've sort of morphed in as the year has gone on, where you have Morneau playing in the back and Araya basically up front looking to cut off balls, a la Durant and Parsons, actually. And you see Morneau does such a great job. He might actually, he rivals certainly Parsons in the ability to, when the ball comes through, to drive it off the screamer from anywhere and keep it low. So it allows Araya to stay there and pick balls off. It's become very, very effective. So how do you see the play going in this match?
Well, as the graphic just had up, but interestingly enough, in one of our semis, which is virtually unheard of these days, okay, we only have one teaching professional on the court, that being Juan Araya, who's at the Greenwich Country Club. I think Juan always plays Juan's game, and he forces other people to adopt. So the common theme playing against Araya Morneau is play Araya in the backcourt and Morneau at the net. The problem, of course, is Morneau's not at the net
very often, right?
And it was interesting, 2 weeks ago in Boston, I saw the statistics from the match, and Juan and Johan each missed like 22 or 24 volleys, which is an astonishing number. Jeff and Mark Parsons missed like 4 and 6 volleys, but it was so deceptive because the other guys weren't at the net.
Right, they're not volleying as much. They're also not creating that havoc and the damage, you know. It's going to be a very interesting match. You know, we should note everybody sees out there on the live stream the steam coming up from the court. The heaters are on. It's a wet morning out here. It doesn't seem to be raining right now, but if the rains come, do you think that favors one team or another, Mark?
You know, I think the weather is a great equalizer. When the conditions are bad, it kind of makes everybody the same. I'm noticing not too much skidding of the ball as they're warming up, but a little.
Yeah, and you can see the weather up there on your screen. We expect it to kind of be like this all day. And the courts, I was out there inspecting the courts before the match. They seem like they're in great shape. You know, there's pretty good grit on the courts. But for all the players out there, they know that the ball is rubber. It does collect water in the courts themselves. If they get wet, the play is different. You know, I would think that if it does rain more, the benefit would be towards Araya and Morneau. You got Morneau hits pretty much a flat ball. You know, and that helps in the rain. And Araya's just, basically, I think he's just got more experience, you know, playing in the rain. Even a couple of years ago, I know he wrote an article for Platform Tennis Magazine on playing in the rain. So we'll see how that affects play as well.
The other real interesting thing to me is yesterday the teams were switching after 7 games. And I tend to think in bad weather conditions, you're better off not switching the ball because it's actually the flocking which absorbs the moisture. And once the flocking wears off, the ball doesn't get quite as wet.
Well, that's an interesting point. You know, so we'll see how that, or how these, you know, players agree on doing that as the match unfolds, too.
Yep, the wonderful world.
Do you have a pick here in today's match?
You know, I give Orion Morneau the slightest of edges. I see a lot of balls sliding on serve.
Certainly saw that warm-up serve there skid into Hughes there.
Yeah.
And that's that's interesting. This, you know, when you're hitting in the wet weather too, sometimes you put a little side spin through the ball, and it will skid out there. If that, you know, does come into play, I think Morneau will probably be the most effective returner of the bunch. You see, when Hughes and Powers are, you know, Hughes hits a pretty flat, but Powers a lot of spin on his ball. All right, looks like the players are taking some last-second conferences, talking about the match, and we're going to be ready to start play soon.
Yeah, the other reason I tend to agree with you about who the bad weather favors is Hughes and Powers tend to be a stronger team from the backcourt.
Players ready?
And obviously bad weather rewards the team at the net. Mark Bliss is our chair umpire.
Steam rising up. Here's our first point underway. Good high lob there from Powers.
And there's the first skid ball today.
Yep, got to be very careful. Concentrate hard getting those lobs up.
And Brad, why don't you talk to our viewers a little bit about the skid ball and how it impacts things. That's another great example.
30 lob.
See, now both those balls would easily have been dug out by Hughes in another day. That ball, he's hitting it low and skidding it through the court. The ball, basically, when it hits the ground, it reacts to the court and bounces up. When the water's on the court, it reacts to the water first, and it skids along. It basically hydroplanes out. And that means that ball's going to stay much lower. It's harder to get your lobs up. And a player with Araya's skill and his ability, he's basically, you know, one of the best cut overhead players in the country, if not the best. He's going to have a field day if he's able to cut those balls in there. You can see him just working them hard into the screens today.
So how would you adjust your strategy as Jeff Morneau's flat over it skids into the wires? What would you do if you're in the backcourt to combat that?
Well, as you said, it could be an equalizer because theoretically the same thing should be able to happen when Hughes and Powers are hitting their overheads too. So it's going to be tough for the backcourt team. So you've
game
got to focus,
Morneau,
like I said, on making
they
sure
lead
that
one
ball
game
is
to love
high
first
and
set.
Deep. If you leave anything short today, even against a guy who doesn't have a cut drop, you're going to be in trouble.
So would you drive the ball more than normal? What else would you do, Brad?
You would be driving the ball a little bit earlier and more, but I think the first thing you do outside of driving more is just concentrate on the depth and height of your lobs first. Get the guys back enough, and then that'll give you more opportunities, and then definitely take more drives, and your drives will probably have to be flatter too.
So a little more aggressive from the backcourt than you might otherwise be.
Because you don't have as many chances to just wait back there. The guys are going to finish the points that much easier.
The ball's really skidding a lot early.
Yep. Now, it's hard to say. We're not outside right now, but we're going to report on what the rain is and what the weather actually is. So.
Does not look very nice out there, dear.
You can see Hughes there, who normally would cut that over. He's pushing it hard and low. There's a skid ball winner there from Powers. All right, right off the bat,
love.
You can see this is going to be the way play is. So yesterday we had 4-minute points and lots of long points. Today we've seen everything super short because the cut overhead's just killing it into the screens. There's a low push. That's a great shot by Moore to take in that early aggressive drive whenever he can.
40 love.
He's feeling it out right now. It's a great view of seeing that ball go through the steam.
Oh,
what a heck of a shot there by Araya. And you see Powers go for a ball there that he normally would drive just because feels if he gets it up, they're going to hit a skid overhead winner, so he's going for it. And you see there, same thing for Morneau. He took a drive
game
low
Hughes
underneath
Powers,
his knees
are one all
and
first
went
set.
For a winning shot because he was afraid to lob.
Switching courts, quick look in there.
15 love.
Like a quick switch.
Real quick. Did you get a good look? Any analysis there, Brad?
That was a drop shot winner for Lubau. And on top of that, I think there might have been
all.
A subliminal message in there, so be careful. Right, that was a fault, two faults there. Serving can become more difficult
15,
in the range, too. See, two push serves there. You can't spin the ball as well. Ball won't come off your paddle. You got to hit through it. Toss this ball up and in front.
Foot fault.
Three faults in a row from Morneau. things 15, like this 40. In a match where you should hold serve all the time, getting a break is going to be crucial. This is a big deal if they can, you know, get this break.
Huge.
Go ahead. So it's 15-30, two break points. He's going to dominate at the net if they can't get this ball up and in there. I do expect the players will get more used to this as it goes on, though. Great shot.
There's just so much 30, more 40. Pressure on your serve in conditions like this. You just can't afford to fault.
Second break point. He's going to have to go for the drive here because it's not that easy. Nope. Got to put up a lob. So far, I haven't seen a backcourt team win a point when they've lobbed yet. He missed the wide. Nope. It's good.
Yeah, very close.
Game, Hughes Powers.
Wow.
They lead two games to long. One. First set.
Little question there called out by Powers. And ball's long. No question, though, from Orion Morneau, confirmed by the umpire. So there's the first break of the match. And, you know, that could be it. We'll see. But getting the breaks in this weather is tricky. So a three-fault game, not going to help. Actually, that was a two-fault and foot-fault game. So for all of you out there, all the players are warned beforehand, you know, that foot faults are going to be called. If you step on the line or anywhere inside the court before you make contact with the ball on your serve, that is a foot fault.
And now we have two faults returned. Very generous morning so far, Brad.
Can be harder to serve in this weather for sure. Get the ball in the box, and the point is 90% yours.
15-30.
The ball skids away from Araya there.
You see two misses there from Jeff and
30 Wong, all.
They're going to make 99 times out of 100. Was that range, Brad?
30-40.
I no idea what that was. That was a whiff.
Might have been steam.
30-40. Yeah. Oh, wow. Gifted right back.
Game of
two
Ryan
more faults.
Morneau.
Whiffed overhead and a missed volley. You know, right now, the rain definitely affecting the quality of players. The players are settling into the match. Flat drive, takes a good look.
15 love.
It's interesting, in some way the weather really takes away from the game. But in some way it's the essence of paddle.
30 love.
Because you simply have to find a way.
Right, you have to adjust, find a way. I think as time goes on, we're gonna see the drives become flatter, a little more through.
40 love.
People are gonna find a way. That drive that Powers hit last time, he sailed the ball, just kind of slapped at it from behind. He's going to have to get over. You know, I would expect you know, one of our last players, Scott Keller, to be a good rain player, too. He has a different kind of flat ball.
Michael Montalbano is a terrific mudder.
Yeah, because he's got that flat, huge backhand that he hits sort of downward.
This looks like a paddle point, Brad.
Might be the longest point of the match so far. That was a great shot there. You'll find in a day like today, Jeff Morneau has a good overhead in the sense like it's not easy to attack it at all, but it's also a great spot there, a nice flat backhand from Powers. But in this weather, his overhead will actually be, he'll be finishing it with his overhead too. Shot.
Game of Raya Morneau.
The game there.
They lead three games to two, first set.
Let me take a moment to thank our sponsors. Viking is the official sponsor of the APTA. Osteo Biflex, Behringer Vineyard, Club Pilates, Maple Crest Ford, Spiro Harrison Law Firm, Narragansett Brewery, and of course the New Jersey Men's Platform Tennis Association. I also want to mention that in 2 weeks we have mixed nationals on Long Island, February 25th, 26th. Junior nationals run by Patty Hogan, March 4th and 5th. And then, of course, the Open Nationals, March 10th, 11th, and 12th in Philadelphia, being run by Tim McAvoy. Lauren Zink and John Orion will be inducted into the Hall of Fame down there.
All right. Well, we're on to our sixth game here. Serves, first serve in the box there by Powers.
Great move from Jeff Morneau. And there's an example to me, Brad, of looking for offense in unusual sources.
Yes, he hits the dink and blitz there instead of the hard shot. Comes in quickly, gets the volley up. Yeah, you see Power still hitting that cut serve. I think it's better to hit through the ball. Nice flat ball there by Morneau.
Oh, my God!
I hear Juan.
15 all.
Missing that lob long. Still not used to the weather yet. That's the shot right there. Be careful. Great ball off
15,
that screen.
30.
And that's one of the things I like to do in the bad weather is drive the ball off the wires.
Yep.
Because the
absolutely.
Ball's heavier and it'll come out a little harder.
That's the drive you're not going to be able to hit very well
all.
Is spinning the ball up. If you're going to hit that, he should go flat right at his body, try to frame him. Because to get that ball in is going to be very difficult in this weather. 30 all. Sitting it hard in there. That's a dangerous shot to Morneau.
Nice
Morneau's
shot,
so good off the back. That's going to be, I think,
30,
one of the big
40.
Advantages right there for Ryan Morneau
in
this weather.
I look for Juan to be more effective with his backhand than his forehand
he
today, Brad.
He drives it through. His forehand's much more loopy shot. Yeah, like that. There you go. It's the ball right there. They keep feeding the ball
game
into Morneau.
Ryan
he crushes
Morneau.
Three drives. They're going
to
have to get
they lead four games
thought
to
process
two.
Going about how they're going to play this match. Right now, they're walking through it. They got the early break. But that's good playing by Morneau. He's a great. Yeah, last game was three faults. Let's see if he gets it in this time. He's a great flat ball hitter. Gives him an advantage in the weather.
Yeah, they got to hit a lot of balls to
Juan's
forehand and to Jeff and to Mark Powers' forehand because they both have that big loopy tennis topspin forehand, which is a great shot in normal weather conditions.
Yeah, you're going to have to adjust today for sure. Right in. Wow, what a shot. There's the ability and confidence Juan has in Morneau. He doesn't even bother to back up as Morneau goes back there to hit
30
that
love.
Close. It should be noted that John Hughes and John Hughes and Jeff Morneau are from the same club in Springfield.
They do practice together a lot, I think.
Drove down together.
Troubles.
So far, your early comment, Brad, about Juan and Jeff being more experienced with this is really coming to the forefront.
Hit it. Hit it.
And one of the 40, ways
15.
You can tell, actually, if it's really raining hard or not, if you look on the screen there, there'll be dry patches if it weren't continuing to rain. But you see the court is completely wet everywhere. So this ball's full moisture. There we go. Five.
Game Orion Morneau.
Two.
Yep.
So they're switching balls after seven games.
5-2.
Do you think this favors one team or another, Brad, switching balls?
I think, you know, that's a good question. If anything, actually, you know, it probably doesn't. But I would say, if anything, it probably would hit Hughes and Powers a little bit. You know, there might be a little less skid on this ball. This ball might react a little more appropriately to start. Look at that flat ball. They got to keep it away from Morneau's forehand. It should be noted from all our viewers there. You can see it's a two-handed shot there. Both hands on the paddle. Extremely quick release. Oh, lucky shot there. Great get. Oh, tough. Couldn't get set.
Great get from Jeff Morneau.
15 love.
one of the things I love about watching Morneau play is he's a great competitor. He's tough, but then he's willing to smile, have a joke
low.
With his competitors all the time. Not sure,
30,
was that called
15.
Long?
30, 15.
Yeah.
Confirmed by Mark Bliss.
Yeah, you can see all their spectators inside with the umbrellas there.
John Hughes is struggling with
all.
The serve early. That's four faults in
yep.
two service games.
Yeah, see, I would not hit those cutters. That's just giving him the best ball he could hit. You want to hit through the ball to make it
30,
skid
40.
Through the court, not cut the ball so it's going to bounce up.
Set point.
That's it. See, that ball skids through the court and
Good.
Hits Araya. And that's the shot you want to hit. You don't want this ball to bounce up and then skid up. That's why.
Another fault from John Hughes. We're 19
minutes
in.
Araya Morneau.
And that's the great thing because, what, the stats are most matches, the average is 6-4, 6-4 in an hour and 50 minutes, basically, right?
Approximately.
So, right. And we're at what, Mark?
19 minutes.
19 minutes, and we got the first set done against
players. Well, not done.
Well, okay. Fair enough. But I guess by the time it's done, we'll get another 10 minutes in us, even if it goes a bunch more games.
There's that topspin forehand
Dude.
That's really hard to control.
If I were him, I would actually go, Juan has it. You know that shot he uses where he holds his bat on front, hits it flat, like a punch forehand? If I were him, I'd use more of that than this roly topspin forehand.
Advantage, Hughes, power.
All right, game point for Hughes. Cut overhead.
Oh, great dig. Another great dig.
Just punishing him in there.
Survival mode right now.
Oh, yeah. First
down
player down.
Hughes. Up goes
He's
Hughes.
Up. Wow. You're about to go down, goes Frazier.
Yeah.
Yeah. Longest point of the match by far, I think. Wow, how about that?
Deuce.
All right, back to deuce. That's a good serve right there. Very low. That's the one he's going to hit through it, not hopping up off the screen. A little tough. Couple of missed volleys from Powers
Dude.
There today. Ball's a little heavier.
It's just hard to get a feel for the ball. Volleying, lobbing, it affects the game everywhere.
Sure. Fault again.
That's number four this game.
Advantage,
yep.
Araya Morneau.
Set point number three.
Oh, did get in on that one.
Game and
game
first
and
set.
First
Araya
set
Morneau, 6-2.
Six games to two.
We'll be back in a minute after these messages right here on the APT Network, presented by ENET Live.
Wealth has a new definition. Today, it's being created by all kinds of business owners, entrepreneurs, and men and women in every profession. At Boston Private, we know them personally because they're our clients. And we have the wealth management and private banking expertise to create a custom approach for your financial life. We're redefining wealth management because you're redefining wealth.
Need customized support? Ace Brand has a brace for you. Introducing the revolutionary Ace Brand knee and elbow strap with custom dial system, made with the same technology that's used in high-tech cycling shoes and ski boots. This custom dial system provides the ultimate in targeted pain relief. It allows you to dial up the exact amount of pressure you need on the injured tendon for maximum comfort. Simply turn the dial and feel the soothing gel pad conform to the precise shape and desired pressure on the tendon to relieve soreness and increase comfort. Get customizable comfort from Ace Brand. Less pain, more game.
Welcome back to the APTA Grand Prix Series presented by eNett Live. We're in the semifinal round here of the men's match between Orion Morneau against Hughes and Powers. And Orion Morneau won the first set, 6-2, in a tough rain-filled set. So, want to talk a little bit about that, Mark?
Well, you and I were talking off-air, Brad, about how nobody tends to play in these conditions. And you can see that Mark and John don't have a lot of experience with it, and they don't have a game plan.
Absolutely. I believe they're the youngest team in the top 10, right? They're basically 26,
yes.
27 years old.
Yep. Mick Adoy and Dan Regan are close.
Close, right. And, you know, they definitely don't have the experience that these guys do. And the tendency is to not practice in this weather, you know, because it is so different. But, you know, platform tennis is an outdoor game played in the wintertime, so conditions do come into play. So it is good to learn this stuff, and I think this will be a good learning experience for them, or certainly they'll understand that they need to go about this a different way or understand how to play in this weather going forward.
Second set.
Well, right now it's apparent to me they have no plan at all. They're just hitting the ball and hoping.
Yep, they're going through the motions right now. It's nice to see them actually have a conversation. You can tell they're talking about, you see Powers there taking a mini four, and I think they're talking about how they want to hit it, what they want to do, because we know Powers and Hughes have tremendous firepower, tremendous ability to hit the ball, but right now all that's being blunted, and they're just trying to figure out how to get a foothold in this match. You know, they're serving wrong, they're getting Morneau actually hitting the returns, you know, hard, and, you know, just at this stage, not quite in there. Oh, that's so well done.
Great exchange from Juan at the net.
Love 15.
He's so good at that. That was a great example of they're maximizing their talents. Jeff's driving, Juan's volleying.
There's your point there about them serving in, Juan using the backhand, which I agree with you. Today it's going to be his better shot. Great dink, and wow, great variety there from Morneau. Ball hard and flat and a heartbeat, and then dinks it. Can't tell the difference.
Love 30.
So we should mention, Mark, that after this we have the ladies' final coming up.
Love
between,
40.
Gabby Niculescu and Martina Andrikova against Roxy Anika and Liz Cruz. So that should be a great, great match coming up at 11 o'clock. And then after that, we'll have the men's final.
In the other semi, Drew Broderick and Jared Palmer are up 4-2. First set over Steve DeRose, John Lubau.
Now, should be mentioned that you had the opportunity to play against DeRose yesterday in your 95s. Win there, Mr. Fischel. Congratulations.
I don't know if I played against him, Brad. I was on the court watching Juan play against him.
There you go. Did you? What part of the court are you allowed to stand in those matches?
The two boards that are in green that are outside the wires next to the wires.
And that's
your
spot.
Is it bad to use a water analogy on a rainy day? Because it's going down the drain really fast.
Yep.
They were up 2-1 after Jeff Morneau played that bad game on his serve. They've lost seven consecutive games in 10, 12 minutes.
No, absolutely, this is some trouble. And I don't, at this point, you know, the plan of either taking that drive earlier and coming in a flat earlier drive hasn't worked yet, but at least they're talking now.
I know.
See that overhead there, that spinning in there over, you want to hit through the ball, let it skid along the court. Like that one's more like it. There you go.
Jordan. Yeah.
There was that flat forehand that Juan hit there instead of that full center. That's the one we don't want to see as much. God, his hands are so good, though.
What a blitz.
I mean, he's taking a volley off his shoe tops and coming in.
with control.
That's confidence.
Little miscommunication there between Jeff and Juan on the lob.
That's a great, great shot there. All right.
Love 30.
Couple of points there, love 30.
Questionable decision by Jeff Morneau to let that ball bounce.
Yeah, you don't want to give up the net today at all. You know, in most days, letting the ball go through when you, you know, feel like you're in trouble is a good play, but in a wet weather day, you want to be at the net. You have to be up there.
Absolutely. It's critical. 15-30. Huge game for Hughes and Powers to get back in. They have to convert this.
Yep. Something good happened in the match.
Yo!
Now, I don't know if you can you tell? Is the ball that's amazing? I think he's apologizing because that was a miss hit, not an intentional shot. Dirty all. The first return I've seen Hughes hit. He's got a big return. That's it. Shortening up, taking that ball early, but Juan right there. He knows they're going to drive more now.
40-30.
Great put away volley.
But they have to be swinging earlier in the point. Lobbing is not working.
That's well played.
Too aggressive from Juan.
Dude.
I don't know if he was trying for a drop volley or, you know, he left that ball short. He needed to volley that one deep.
But he should have let Jeff hit the ball.
Yep.
Ball was, call is correct.
Jeff faults.
Advantage, Hughes, power.
Break point.
Right. See if he drives this one through, he's going to lob it.
I mean, that's the ball John Hughes makes 100 times out of 100.
Yeah, he just didn't read it. He thought it was going to move or skid a different way, because that's what also happens. The ball skids, and then sometimes
it doesn't. Morneau.
It just keeps you off balance.
They really look lost, Brad.
Reach the Nick.
Three love.
Three games to love. Second set. Mariah Morneau won the first set.
Now, you'd mentioned before, Mark, that we have the upcoming national championships, but we also have the league championship. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Chicago, April 1st and 2nd. Pete Rose and John Noble are preparing for 1,200 people. First ever APTA league championship.
And what
really
is
exciting.
What is that program?
Leagues around the country. Everybody from just above the beginner level to just under the professional level.
Yeah.
So we encourage all teams if they want to enter from anywhere.
And you need an eight-man team from your league, right?
Yep, eight-man.
Eight-person.
Oh, what a sequence, Brad. Did anybody do that better?
15-all.
He's amazing at that. I mean, you know, obviously Johan Durant's incredible at the blitz and volley exchange, but Juan is, he's right there, one of the best. And I tell you that
30-15.
We've seen now as the Morneau and Araya partnership has, you know, blossomed here. You know, they're going to be, you know, at this point, they're the third seeds at Nationals.
30-all.
Third seed at Nationals will not change based on anything that transpires
right
today.
So, I mean, obviously the first and second seeds are Broderick and Palmer and Durant and Parsons. And actually, Hughes and Powers will end up being the fourth seed at Nationals, right?
Yep, that's correct.
Yeah, so those seeds are locked in based on the results of this last Grand Prix tournament. You know, and we'll see, as I was saying, that as their, you know, teamwork has blossomed, you're seeing Juan doing even more blitzing, so comfortable at the net because he's so comfortable with Morneau behind him.
But there's an example of inexperience. You should never hit a waterfall overhead in these weather conditions.
Of course not. Don't give anything high to hit downward. That's the real offensive opportunity for your opponents in this weather. That should do it. Great cut finish.
30-40.
All right. We had a first set of about 21 minutes or so. You gonna take any bets on the over-under here?
Can I wait till the end of this point?
Oh, that's so well placed.
I'll take the under.
Just dominated there. But game see, the Araya loss there, no. Now they're lost with their positioning, their court play, the whole works.
Well, you can see the shot selection having nothing to do with the rain is now spotty. Beaten by a Nick before, you wouldn't expect. Nine consecutive games won by Araya and Morneau.
If this match does finish early,
we're checking to see if we can switch to the other semi. Mark Powers starting to take a few more cuts.
He's got to hit that one. Great shot right there. Found the forehand volley. Great spot.
Love 30.
All right. Well, we do know that Hughes and Powers have always been a great comeback team and played very well from behind, but this is a different feel to it right now.
What are we, 15-30?
Okay, so yeah. For technical reasons, we're going to be unable 15, to bring 30. You the other match.
Go. Great play, but well defended there.
I like some of the adjustments Mark Powers is making.
Yep. They're learning as they're going.
No!
It's going to be a great experience for them.
30 all.
6-2-1 love, Broderick Palmer on the next court.
You see Powers throwing a blitz there, realizing they're not having great success in the backcourt developing a point. So he's got pretty good hands, too. Oh, that's a great hit.
Huge forehand.
Yeah, well,
another break up. 30, 40.
Getting a setup there. But
another break opportunity for Hughes and Bowers.
Starts with one game.
That was a ball John should have swung at.
He could have hit, for sure. And he has that shot, but I wouldn't say he fully has it with the confidence. You know, it's that ball you see Juan do all the time.
Game, Hughes, Powers.
Drive through it, but they do get the break. So they're down 4-1, but I think if they get this one, we'll say it's the start of a comeback.
It's interesting. They've won three games, two of them on breaks. They've only held serve once the entire match.
Yep.
Day like today, you never would have expected that.
I tell you what, Morneau, though, you know, and Araya, they don't really seem to be off their game at all. Morneau's crushing drives. They know what to do. They're playing a great match.
Mark Powers to serve.
Such a good ball. That's some better volley technique. Now, Hughes has been working on his volley. It's improved as the season's gone on. You know, technically, he's becoming much better up there. That was good. Couple of volleys where Hughes was right in there.
15 love.
Stuffing the ball back. Turnaround drive.
15 all.
Morneau doing such damage back there, and Juan coming in to the net.
Decision just misses it.
I think he got a little greedy. 30, I think he tried to put it right up over his head, kind of sneak it in there. Wow.
40-15. Chance to get to 4-2.
Touch there. Good touch there by Hughes.
Game Hughes.
Great
Powers.
Volley.
Yeah, he dinked it low. He saw Juan coming in. He took the pace off, got it under the net.
Ryan Marno, 4-2. Four games to one. Four games to two. Oh, yeah, that's on the other page. Sorry.
New ball.
So interesting. They switched after the first seven and now six.
No, it's the first because they played eight games in the first set. They switched
six,
it 5-2,
right.
So it is another seven games.
Yep.
So we played a total of 14 games, so it's 7-7.
And this change of the balls is really going to help Morneau and Araya, because it definitely helps the server serving with that new ball.
That's a good ball. Since that first game, Morneau, I don't think he's faulted yet.
You can see the ball skidding a little bit more now that it has the flocking on it again, as it starts to absorb the water.
Serve it to Kreese, good. He's got to take a cut at those.
40 love.
That hard, low ball right near the body. And it doesn't come up off the screen. You just can't handle the block. He's getting fooled twice on those spins to the inside. All right, just dominating and dictating
game
with the overhead there. Great shot.
5-2, second set.
So John Hughes to serve, 2-5, second set. John has not held serve yet today.
Right here, 2-5 down. Vaulted wide three or four times.
Wide, you wouldn't expect that.
I mean, he's trying to keep it away from the Morneau forehand, which has been crushing, but you know, it's just too many faults. That's been about seven, I believe, seven or eight.
It's funny because Jeff and John play together, as I mentioned, and Jeff was saying to me last night that he doesn't return John's serve particularly well from the deuce court. He crushes it from the ad court.
Well, lefties do serve much better to the dew court in general. And the reason being, he can, in different weather, hit that spin serve into the side wire. Today, he's not able to do it very well.
Juan pulls out the two-handed backhand, as if he didn't have enough shots.
30.
Right. He's been working on it for a while, and he does pull it out from time to time. Is he using that more of a continental grip forehand?
And again, the waterfall overhead. Just misses it wide, confirmed by Mark Bliss. Double match point.
There it is. You can see Hughes, he's smiling over there. He's like, I don't know what to do, I think. That was a tough serve there. Great get.
Great dig from Juan.
Great dig. Good blitz. That's it.
Game, set, and match. Araya Morneau, 6-2, 6-2.
Well, there's not a lot to talk about there, I think, Mark. It was just workmanlike fashion. They just have a lot more experience playing in the wet weather. And that came to the forefront. Morneau's flat drives and Juan's ability to also drive the ball flat and blitz in behind it. They just had a lot more going on today.
Well, the big story for me is the inexperience from Hughes and Powers. They clearly didn't know how to deal with the weather conditions. They didn't have a plan.
Yep, that's a tough one. So we'll see if we can get some more reports on the other matches. We have upcoming finals, 11 o'clock, women's final, 1 o'clock men's final.
Okay, we'll be back in a moment after these messages right here on the APTA Network. We're going to have an interview with Jerry Vion. Okay, so we're going to go to commercial break. We'll be back with Jerry Vion.
Go Wildcats!
The more they raise their hands out there, the more they'll raise their hands in here. Good Sports gives kids the lifelong benefits of sports by providing equipment to those most in need. Donate today, because kids who play do better.
Welcome back to the APTA Grand Series presented by eNet Live. We're going to go down to the court for an interview with Jerry Viant with our winners, Juan Araya and Jeff Morneau. Jerry, take it away.
Guys, congratulations in these tough conditions. Talk to me about the match.
It was tough. From the first point of the match, the ball was skidding on the court. It was very hard to set up the point from the backcourt, so Jeff and I decided to not lob and try to make them volley, because that way they were not going to be able to spin the ball as much. So we drove balls hard, some off pace, but trying to not give them any opportunities to attack the wires, which when the ball was hitting the wire was kind of dying. So we said we're not going to lob or try to lob as little as possible. So
Jeff, this is a match for sure where experience really played off, because you guys looked comfortable and they didn't quite know what to do.
Yeah, I think we've played a lot more in the rain and in bad conditions than they have. And in the beginning of the match, it was really tough. Quite frankly, I was nervous in that first service game, as you could probably tell up there. I faulted three times in that game because I just wanted to get the serve in, because we knew it would skid. But eventually, we found our rhythm, and it was hard for them to adapt. And we got going. And when Juan gets going, his forehand was going. We were driving the ball, making it really tough for them at the net. So that's why the match was so lopsided, obviously. And I think in different conditions, the match is a lot longer and a lot closer. But today, the experience, I think, really was the difference.
And I mean, in our sport, going through the winter months, you've got to be ready to play in warm conditions, wet conditions, cold conditions.
Yeah, unfortunately, and I tell this to a lot of members at the club, nobody wants to play when it's raining, or nobody wants to practice, but you have to be ready, because in paddle, the matches don't get canceled due to the rain or snow. But nobody really wants to get out in these conditions. And if you practice one or two ice, at least you to have a plan when you go out there and play, it makes a difference. It does make a difference. But of course, I mean, I'd much rather be watching TV in front of the fireplace than playing paddle today. But
yeah, but mental toughness came through once again, Jeff.
Yeah, not me. I'd prefer to be here, Juan. So I enjoy playing in almost any conditions. And this sleet is actually a little better than the rain, quite honestly. Makes it a little slicker, but it's a different style match, and that's fun to play too. You get to play in warm, you get to play in cold, you get to play. So that's what paddle's all about. Playing in the outdoors in the middle of the winter, you never know what the conditions you're going to get, and you got to make, no matter what match it is, fun to play.
Really, really fun watching you guys flourish and survive, and you're into another final. Any thoughts on potential matchup?
Which one at a time. We're really enjoying the time on the court together, and I mean, I just do whatever Captain Jeff says. I just go on the court and say, okay, Jeff, what's the plan? I'm just hitting the shots. He tells me to do what I have to do, and I just try to execute, but he's the one that has all the plans.
He executes, let's put it that way. And that's why we're where we are. And we'll see what happens over there. And these sloppy conditions, it's anybody's match. I think it was anybody's match before. I think over there, you never know what's going to happen. So we're looking forward to playing either team.
All right. Well, good luck, and get dry and warm and come up with, go listen to his game plan, and then I want to hear it.
Okay.
We'll
All
see
right.
if it works. See
All
you,
right.
Jerry.
Thanks, you guys.
Thanks.
You. All right. Back to you guys.
Series presented by eNet Live. We were able to get you some coverage here of the other semifinal match between John Lubow and Steve DeRose against Jared Palmer and Drew Broderick, the number one and number eight seeds in this tournament. And you can see in the action there, it's raining heavily right now, rain and sleet. So, Mark, what do you see in this match?
Well, one of the things, Brad, that I want to talk about is how the weather is going to impact the finals. I think Lubao de Rose are down 5-1, second set. So they're switching balls. So first set, we understand, was 6-2. So switching after 14 games, that would make it 5-1.
It is 5-1. We've just got confirmation from APTA President Scott Bondurant. And, you know, at this stage, we'll hope for a comeback here. 5-1 down against the number one seeds, and he misses his first serve there for love 15.
How do you think the weather's going to impact the finals if Broderick Palmer gets through?
Yeah, it's a great question. We were just talking off air a second ago, and you and I both believe this will actually probably as good a cut as, you know, Drew has. I think it'll actually help Ryan Morneau. I think Morneau is going to be the best rain hitter out there. And, you know, I saw Juan playing incredibly well with his flat balls, too. You know, so I think it'll actually give them a slight advantage for sure. And I think Araya actually has confidence. We talked about his lack of confidence in the past playing against, you know, against Durant and Parsons. But I think he has more confidence when he plays against Broderick and Palmer.
Well, he and Max LaVere played him three sets in the finals here. And then obviously at Nationals, they lost to him 6-4 in the third. That's 40-15 this game.
And you can see here, as the weather goes on, watch how John Lubao, the server, is putting his serve in the box. He is afraid to hit it hard. He's just spinning it in. And they get that first volley in. Now, Steve DeRose also has incredible slash overheads. And Lubao has one of the best drops in the game. Now the question is holding serve, although they were down 5-1, is the easy part. Now they got a break.
Steve is remarkable. What a talented athlete. Amazing game. 51 years old, still playing at a tremendous level. Won the league classic with his assistant, three tremendous wins, he and Jamie Ferraro.
Oh, no. Steve, without a doubt, is always considered one of the top, you know, three, four, five players in the game. And he's right there. It's actually, people call him basically like a wizard or a magician with the paddle.
And we should note he's playing the deuce court. He started playing the deuce court the last month or so.
It's a new change for them.
John to the ad.
Now what you see DeRose just do there, moving inside the court, taking a half volley. He's probably the best in the game at that. He'll hit a shot, move inside the court, and you'll go at him, and he half volley lobs you with incredible consistency and control.
You can see these players are so precise that the weather's really throwing them off. That ball that Steve missed off the wire is the ball you'd never expect him to miss.
Yeah, in terms of talent and shot making, he is basically as good as anyone in the game. And, you know, primarily he has good focus, but there are times where you will catch DeRose in a, you know, little bit of a walkabout.
And maybe not even a little bit of one.
Great shot.
Great
move
blitz
there.
By Lubao.
Great move there.
He is quick for a guy his age.
Now, Lubao's a great blitzer. He has that forehand that he hits low to the court, and he comes in behind it.
Oh.
There's the ace. I'm starting to see, I don't know if you are, you know, you have Drew Broderick with that kind of signature take back on his overhead, the way he cocks that paddle up. I'm seeing more players taking up the game starting to do that, taking their paddle up quickly and in position to learn to hit those cut overheads.
30 all. Great ball from Lubao. A little bit of a comeback, Brad. That's to get one of the two breaks back.
That's good low overhead there, tough. Now, did you have any discussions with Lubao and DeRose as to why they switched sides halfway through the season?
Steve wanted to play the deuce.
There you go, there's a good a reason as any. control forehand. All right, so this is match point now.
Just a beautiful day here at the Short Hills Club. Yes. If you're a duck.
Yeah, exactly. I think I'm going to go for a walk after this.
I'll meet you back at the clubhouse, Brad.
Perfect. Bring me a towel. There it is, game, set, and match. Roderick with the cut over heading to the corner. So let's talk for a second about the final, Mark. So we have two great teams, the 1 and 2 seeds. In fact, we had, you know, just a great tournament here. But so how do you see the final going?
Well, both teams won 6-2, 6-2, ironically enough. And I think your comments earlier are right in the money. I think that you're not going to see the inexperience, obviously, so from Hughes and Powers. But Jeff Morneau's ability to hit the ball flat and the vast array of offensive weapons that Juan Araya has, I think I make them a slight favorite.
You know, it's going to be a great match. I mean, in this weather too, we'll see how these competitors go, because the weather also kind of, you have to keep your intensity up. It can drill you down a little bit too, the miserable conditions. Well, so
you're going to miss some really bad shots. I know a lot about missing really bad shots, Brad, from my experience. And you just have to play through it. You have to understand that's going to be part of the game, and you can't let it impact your confidence.
Yep.
Yeah, in a tri-court, clearly Broderick Palmer would be the favorite going in. But as we talked earlier, the weather is a great equalizer, and I think Juan and Jeff are really well suited to these types of conditions.
I agree. So we look forward to a terrific final upcoming at 11 o'clock. We got the women's final. And do you see anything in that match, Mark?
I think that's a tremendous matchup. I think those are the two best teams in the country right now. Roxy Anika and Gabby Niculescu are probably the two best individual players in the country. It's going to be fun to watch.
You know, it's interesting, though. Roxy is, in terms of talent, ball striking, the ability to do things. But she has shown that sort of mental drop-off in these critical moments. Faults are almost like shaky getting the serve in at tops. Perfect time. So you clearly would give the edge in those types of situations to Niculescu and Andrikova, who have not shown that.
Absolutely. But I thought yesterday was a big day for Roxy. She wasn't playing well. She was struggling. Barely got through in their quarterfinal match. She was cramping. 7-6 in the third with Dardis Shea in the semis.
Who, by the way, are just warriors.
Warriors. Absolute warriors. But those are the types of matches Roxy has lost for years and years. And yesterday, she found a way.
Yeah, well, we're looking for a great final in the women's game. And I think we'll be back after these messages.
Yeah, let me take a moment to thank our sponsors one more time. Viking, the official sponsor of the APTA, who does so much for the game. Alex Banchilla, just a tremendous asset to our sport. Osteo Biflex, who's sponsoring the Short Hills Invitational, along with Behringer Vineyard, Club Pilates. Brad, you should try that out. I've noticed I think you need
Club
to work on that.
A little core work?
Yeah, just a little. Sean was telling me that.
I'll put it on the list.
Yeah, Maple Crest Ford, Spiro Harrison Law Firm, Narragansett Brewery, which we all really appreciate their product, the New Jersey Men's Platform Tennis Association. And then I also wanted to bring up that we have the APTA Mixed Nationals and the Husband Wives, 2 weeks in Long Island, followed by Junior Nationals in New Jersey, March 4th and 5th. And then, of course, we conclude our season with the Open Nationals, March 10th, 11th, and 12th in Philadelphia. And our Hall of Fame inductions will be, I guess, the night of March 11th, Jerron Horine and Lauren Zink, two remarkably deserving candidates. So we'll be back at 11 o'clock with our women's semifinals right here on the APTA Network, presented by ENet Live. Women's finals right here on ENet Live.